I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Time. They say that our time is measured in seconds. God's time is not measured at all, because God exists in eternity. He deals with us in time, but he does so from the aspect of seeing all things, all time. He sees the past, present, and the future all at the same time. Now, which of the two, those of us, we who measure time by seconds, or God who measures time by eternity, which of us would have the better timing? I think we'd have to say God, wouldn't we? And that's the point today as we listen to the gospel lesson. Everything in God's good time, which is always good for us. We think on that as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Greetings to you this morning. Welcome to our service here at Trinity Lutheran Church. We follow the order of service as it's printed for you in your worship folders this morning. We'll open with the first hymn that's listed there. We sing verses 1 through 5. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who has given your only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake grant us remission of all our sins. And by your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will, and true obedience to your word, to the end that by your grace we may come to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us and has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. To those who believe on his name, he gives power to become the children of God and has promised them his Holy Spirit. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all. All the earth shall worship you and sing to you, O God. They shall sing to your name, O Most High. Praise the Lord. O God, Father in heaven, your heart, O God, is grieved, we know, by every evil, every woe. Upon your cross forsaken Son, our death is laid and peace is won. O Son of God, Redeemer of the world, your arms extend, O Christ, to save from sting of death and grasp of grave. Your scars before the Father move his heart to mercy at such love. O God, Holy Spirit, O lavish giver, come to aid the feeble child your grace has made. How to make us grow and make us pray, bring joy and comfort, come to stay. Please be seated. Let us give glory to our God. Almighty and everlasting God, who governs all things in heaven and earth, mercifully hear the prayers of your people and grant us your peace all the days of our lives. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Old Testament reading for this Sunday comes from the prophet Amos, chapter 11. In that day I will raise up the fallen booth of David and wall up its breaches. I will also raise up its ruins and rebuild it as in the days of old, that they may possess the remnant of Edom and all the nations who are called by my name, declares the Lord who does this. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when the plowman will overtake the reaper, and the treader of grapes him who sows seed. And the mountains will drip sweet wine, and all the hills will be dissolved. Also I will restore the captivity of my people Israel, and they will rebuild the ruined cities and live in them. They will also plant vineyards and drink their wine and make gardens and eat their fruit. And I will plant them on their land, and they shall not again have been uprooted out of their land, which I have given them, says the Lord your God. This is the word of the Lord. Our psalm portion comes from Psalm 67. God be gracious to us and bless us.
And cause his face to shine upon us.
That your way may be known on the earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God.
Let all the peoples praise you.
Our epistle comes from St. Paul as he writes to the Ephesian congregation in chapter 5. Wives, be subject to your own husbands as to the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife as Christ also is the head of the church, he himself being the Savior of the body. But as the church is subject to Christ, so also wives ought to be to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her, so that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water with the word, that he might present to himself the church in all her glory, having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she would be holy and blameless. So husbands also ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ also does the church, because we are members of his body. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is great, but I am speaking with reference to Christ and the church. Nevertheless, each individual among you also is to love his own wife, even as himself, and the wife must see to it that she respects her husband. This too is the word of the Lord. The Lord sent his word and healed them and delivered them from destruction. Praise him, all you his angels. Praise him, you hosts of heaven. Hallelujah. Rise for the reading of the gospel. Our gospel today comes from John chapter 2, beginning at verse 1. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there, and both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does that have to do with us? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Whatever he says you to do, do it." Now there were 6 stone water pots set there for the Jews' custom of purification, containing 20 or 30 gallons each. Jesus said to them, "Fill the water pots with water." And so they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Draw some out now and take it to the head waiter." And they took it to him. When the head waiter tasted the water, which had become wine, and did not know where it came from, but the servants who had drawn the water knew, the head waiter called the bridegroom and said to him, "Every man serves good wine first, and then, and the people have had drunk freely, then he serves the poorer wine. But you have kept the good wine until now." This beginning of his signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee, and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. Here ends the gospel. We confess our Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for the hymn of the day. Grace, peace, mercy, and truth be multiplied unto you through Jesus Christ, your Lord, and your Savior. Amen. God's word upon which we concentrate this morning briefly is taken from our gospel reading, again, as it will be this entire church year, and concentrating today on verse 4. Jesus said to her, Mary, "Woman, what does that, lack of wine, have to do with us?" Jesus and his disciples. "My hour has not yet come." O Lord, sanctify us with your truth. Your word alone is truth. Amen. Please be seated. Dear Christian friends, timing is, as they say, everything. You can just ask the Miami Dolphins or perhaps the Pittsburgh Steelers, about timing. Yesterday, one team had the misfortune of taking the field when it was many degrees below zero. I refrained from looking at the temperature because it brought back very bad memories. The problem with a lot of events in life, sports events, concerts, and things like that, is trying to time everything just right is very difficult. It just can't always be done. No matter what you do, no matter how hard you try, you plan things, you maybe plan way in advance, but, you know, you can do a lot of things about a lot of things, but there's nothing you can do about the weather, right? But when it comes to timing, one thing we need to always remember as believers is that God, and especially Jesus, who sits at his right hand and rules the universe for us, God is the master of good timing. God is the creator, if you will, of the proper time, the right time, just the right moment. Now, I understand, you might not think so. You might imagine that certain things that have happened in your life were exactly the opposite of good timing. And I can understand that. I wouldn't argue with you necessarily. From a human standpoint, that's true. We can look at a flat tire on a vacation. We can look at a child coming down sick on Christmas morning. We can think of many things in our lives that we would say is far from the best timing. And again, humanly, we would be right. But one thing you should know for certain, always, is that everything that happens in your human life, everything that happens to you on this earth, as a matter of fact, everything that happens to everybody on this human earth, everything that happens to anybody in this entire universe from the beginning, from Adam and Eve until the last day, everything is timed perfectly by God. That is, timed perfectly for the salvation of believers, your salvation, and the salvation of every other believer who will, at the end, finally make it to heaven on the last day. And so we look at Jesus' first miracle, we listen to what he says, we listen to his mother and her request and Jesus' answer, and we say, is this good timing? Was Mary in good timing? Was Jesus in good timing or not? And the answer that Scripture gives is the timing was and always will be and is perfect. It's especially perfect for you and me. Now, it was early in Jesus' public ministry, and he was still up in Galilee, spending most of his time up there. He was well known there. His family was well known. We know that. People referenced that the fact they knew he was the son of Joseph the carpenter. They knew his brothers and sisters. They knew his mother. His mother was well known and invited to this wedding down in Cana, which is not that far from Nazareth. And I'm sure the people had dealings with one another and commerce and whatever. And so this wedding celebration was there. And probably like most wedding celebrations of Jesus' day in Israel, it went on the recommended or the mandated 7 days. 7 days was the wedding. Imagine your father of the bride having to prepare a reception for 7 days. Well, that's the way it was. Sometime during this 7 days of celebration, they ran out of wine, which you can probably assume is something that happens from time to time and would be very embarrassing to the host family. The matter of fact is, they had also run out of purification water. And you understand that whenever the Jews are going to eat, whenever they're going to participate in a meal, they, like your mother taught you, would wash their hands. This wasn't done so much for germs or whatever as it was done in a purification sense. It was done because of the Old Testament laws and such. It was done because this was part of their ritual. And so they had these water jars, very large water jars, holding 20, 30, 40 gallons, some of them, and they were empty by now. And so this must be kind of towards the end of the celebration, probably the sixth day, seventh day. The text says third day, but we're not sure if that means the third day of the week or the third day of the wedding celebration. I think it's third day of the week. So I think what's going on here is that this is getting towards the end. So that's why these pots were ready for Jesus' miracle. And Mary then sees this problem, and she does not want the host family, maybe they're shirt-tail relations, cousins or something, and she does not want them to be embarrassed. She does not want them to be looked upon as being bad hosts. And so she goes to her son. She knows there's no way that they can make more wine, or they can go get more wine, or there's the money to buy more wine. She knows all those things. That's out of the question. So the only answer to the question is somehow with her son. Somehow her son, Jesus, she knows, of course, is the Son of God, and so she figures that in some way Jesus can fix the problem. And so she goes to him and she says, "Hey, Jesus, they have no wine." Now, of course, Jesus knew that anyway. He didn't have to be told, and he could have done something about it himself right away if he wanted to, but that's not happening. Now, Mary probably thought to herself, "Boy, what an opportunity. If I use this opportunity just right, I can reveal the true nature of my son, and he will really take off in his ministry. That would be a great help for the plan of salvation." I'm not saying that she was thinking of herself or anything like that. She probably was thinking, here, God, let me help. I will help you with the plan of salvation. Let me get involved, and I will do something that will kind of give Jesus' ministry a little boost, huh? And so Jesus turns to her, and he says, hey, wait a minute. What? This doesn't have anything to do with me. Why do you involve us, me and my disciples? In other words, he's talking about us because he's talking about his ministry. And notice what he says. He doesn't say, "Mommy, please." He says, "Woman." Now this, you might think, was harsh. It wasn't harsh. He wasn't saying, you know, "Hey, dumb lady" or "dumb woman." He wasn't saying that. He was just addressing her, "Hey, woman." In other words, the relationship had changed. Since his baptism and temptation in the wilderness and his preaching, he's gone on now for some time already, the relationship between Jesus and his mother had changed. It was no longer a mother and son relationship. Well, that was there, but that wasn't the primary relationship anymore. The relationship was, you might say, pastor and mother, or even more so, savior and mother, redeemer and mother, gospel preacher and mother. Okay, so it was a woman, a sinner, okay, who also needed to be redeemed. All right, also needed to hear law and gospel, all right, a member of his flock, you might say, and not simply a blood relative, a mother figure, a parent, or whatever. Jesus' reply then also says, "My time has not yet come." Now, we know what happens after this, and so we're a little perplexed by that. We know that he goes ahead and does a miracle, so we wonder, why does Jesus say, "My time has not yet come," when we know full well what he plans to do? In other words, he plans to do a miracle. Okay, you can call this a gospel exception, right? We don't know in the mind of God, in the mind of Jesus, that he had a different first miracle planned. I think we can safely say he did not. I think we can safely say that what happens is God's will, and therefore this was always planned as the first miracle of Jesus' ministry. So again, why does he say this? My time has not yet come. Basically, what it means very simply is my time has not come in the sense of my time and yours. My time has not yet come for us. My time has not yet come for you. My time has not yet come that you can call the shots, Mommy. Okay? My time has not yet come that you decide. Now, Jesus can still decide to do the miracle. That's not the point of his comment. The point of his comment is to put her in her place and say, hey, it's not up to you. That's all that it means, folks. Don't read into it any more than that. Don't read into it that Jesus says, well, I'm not going to do a miracle now. No, don't read into that, because of course he obviously does. He's simply saying, it is not for you to choose. Okay? It is not for you to decide when I do my first miracle. And that also, I think, must have hit Mary, must have really been understood by Mary, because what does she do? She turns to the servants and she says, whatever he tells you to do, do it. I mean, you think about it. Jesus could have done anything. Jesus could have said, spit in each one of the containers. Put dirt in every one of the containers. He could have told them to do anything. The fact that he told them to fill them back up with water wasn't all that unusual. But the fact that she said, whatever he tells you to do, do it. Okay. That then tells me that Mary was a true believer, and that Mary really did expect Jesus to do some fantastic and miraculous thing. My dear Christian friends, this is a lot of our problem today when it comes to our relationship with God. It is God's decision, it is God's choice to time things in our lives. And I know sometimes we have a problem with that. I know we have difficulty. But it is a fact. We cannot demand that God show us his power whenever it suits us. Let me repeat that. We cannot demand that God shows us his power in our lives whenever it suits us. We can ask. We can request. We can plead even. We can beg. But we cannot demand that God do that. God will choose the time, the place, and the manner, and the means to give us evidence of his almighty control in this world, in our lives, when it suits him. Not when it suits us. That is a great truth of this lesson. We cannot prescribe the circumstances surrounding his wonders. What we need to do is have faith. We need to have faith that he will perform them, and that he will, at a time and a place and in a way which is best for our eternal salvation. This was Mary's faith. Mary's faith, that's why she said what she did. That's why she said, hurry, go and fill up these pots with water. She didn't say that. Or hurry and go and find some wine flagons. She didn't say that. She said, do whatever he tells you to do. And the inference also is, whenever he tells you to do it. He might tell you 4 hours from now. That needs to be our faith, folks. Our faith and Mary's faith. It needs to be the same. Okay, God, here's my problem. Here's my issue. I'm sick, or I'm sick and tired, or I'm poor, or my husband or my wife is sick, or my kids, or my kid took off for a trip someplace and I haven't heard from him in a while, or whatever. Here's my problem, Lord. You deal with it. I've done what I can. I've got GPS on his phone, and he turned it off. Or whatever. Whatever the problem happens to be. All right, God, your time, in your manner, you deal with it. That's basically what Mary said. Whatever he tells you, go ahead and do. Whatever. Doesn't matter what. Doesn't matter when. Doesn't matter how. Doesn't matter. Just let him decide. Let him pick out how he's going to fix this problem. That's exactly what she said in so many words. And that needs to be our attitude also. Believing the problem will be solved one way or another by Jesus in his good time, in his good way, in his good manner. Maybe his solution will be our going to heaven. Okay? I mean, that's a solution, isn't it? Now, granted, we probably don't ask it that way. Okay? I understand that. And that's fine. You know, you don't have to ask it that way. But understand that that's one of God's options. Oh, is that a problem for you? Hey, okay. I won't take the problem away from you. I'll take you away from the problem. Hey, that's the way it goes sometimes. When Jesus began his ministry, we're told that after his baptism, his temptation, he went out into the desert and he began preaching to the people. He began preaching to the people and he began assembling disciples. A lot of time gone by between his beginning of the ministry and this miracle in Cana. A lot of time. Months. We know he already had six disciples at this time. Andrew, Peter, James, John, Philip, and Nathaniel. So Jesus had already become pretty famous, pretty well known. He had a cadre of followers already. And notice, no miracle yet. You got to kind of wonder that, huh? Why didn't Jesus, as he came up from his baptism, and the dove flew away, right? And God said, this is my son and all that. Okay, that was God's miracle. But not Jesus' miracle necessarily. Why didn't Jesus immediately turn around and start healing lepers? Why didn't Jesus immediately turn around and start making lame people walk? Why didn't Jesus immediately go to the first town, find some dead people and raise them from the dead? He didn't do that. You and I, if we were planning his ministry, if we were plotting it all out like a script, we would probably say, now Jesus, as soon as you get out of that water, go find somebody and get a demon out of them. That's probably how we would have designed it. But Jesus did not design it that way. Again, why? Because he wants his word, his word, his word, his word, his word, the means of grace, the gospel and word and sacrament. He means that to be the means by which we are saved, my friends. He means that to be the means by which we are establish our relationship with God. He wants those to be the means by which we are comforted, by which we are given peace, by which we live our lives. This, unfortunately, is where far too people stop in their Christianity. They acknowledge Jesus as Lord and Savior, and then they expect that Jesus as Lord and Savior, Lord over their lives, like, oh yeah, Lord, be Lord over my life. They expect that everything to go along hunky-dunky. They expect everything to be a bowl of peaches. They expect to be happy and everything go well, and everything have been that they're healthy, wealthy, and wise. And when they're not, when it doesn't, when the prosperity preachers prove to be false, which they always do, for someone, people get in despair. These are false prophets, my friends. Anyone who tells you that your life will be wonderful once you give it to Jesus is blowing smoke up your dress. They're handing you a line. that is false. What happened next, of course, proves that Jesus is God. It proves it in three ways. It proves because Jesus turned water into wine. It proves it because he turned it into a whole lot of wine, about 150 gallons. And it proves it because he turned it into the best wine that the head waiter have ever tasted in his entire life. When God acts, folks, you will be able to see it. When God acts, you will be able to know it. Maybe not right away. You know, God may act when you're 21 or 22 and you don't see it until you're 85. Maybe you don't see it until you're heaven. But you'll see it. Eventually, you'll see it. You'll see it all planned out. And when you get to heaven, you will see that the timing for all the things of your life, the timing of your birth, the timing and the place where you grew up, the timing of your marriage, the timing of your children, and the timing of your death. You will see all of those things in the grand panorama of the believer in heaven, and you will say, "Boy, God, did you ever hit the nail on the head? Wow, man, you couldn't have done better if you tried." Which, of course, is true. So next time you hear this wonderful story of Jesus' first miracle, I want you to think about timing. I want you to remember, in this world, timing is everything. And I want you to remember that God's timing, whatever we may think of it, is perfect. It's perfect for God, but more importantly, perfect for you. And now the peace of God that goes beyond all understanding will keep your hearts and minds in true faith through Christ Jesus your Lord. Amen. Please be seated for prayer. O God, we, your unworthy servants, do give you most humble and hearty thanks for all your goodness and loving kindnesses to all people. We praise you for our creation, our preservation, and the blessings of this life, but above all for your great love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. Give us a proper sense of all your mercies, that our hearts may be always thankful, and that we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but with our lives. Cause us to live in holiness, that we may enjoy the blessings of a peaceful conscience and the benefits of your favor. Sustain and comfort us in all the troubles of life, and bring us to your everlasting kingdom. Govern your church so as to keep all Christian congregations in the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. Send down upon all ministers the Spirit of your grace, so that they may strive to please you. Watch over all in authority and grant them wisdom, so that they may seek to do your holy will. Increase all good works in our nation, so that peace and contentment may continue among us, and that our people make your saving gospel known to all nations. Protect all that travel, rescue all that are in peril, and satisfy the godly needs of your children. We commend to you all those who are afflicted in mind or body. Comfort and relieve them according to your will, and give them patience in their suffering. Accept our humble requests in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we pray in his name. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then he took the cup, and he gave thanks. And he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." It must be known that such people, as deprive themselves of and withdraw from the sacrament so long a time, are not to be considered Christians. But he has commanded his Christians to eat and drink it, and thereby remember him. Congregation may now come forward for the Lord's Supper. Take and eat, this is the true body of the Lord. This is his blood shed for you. May this strengthen and preserve you in the true faith and to life everlasting. Amen. Depart in peace. Take and eat, this is the true body of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, given up unto death, even the death of the cross, for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take and eat, this is the true body of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, given for you on the cross, for your sins. This is the blood of your Savior, shed for your sins. Take and eat. This is the true body of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, given for you on Calvary's cross for the forgiveness of all of your sins. This is the true body of your Lord, sacrificed for you on Calvary's cross for the forgiveness of your sins. This is the true blood of your Savior, shed for you. This is the true body of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, sacrificed for you on Calvary's cross for the forgiveness of all of your sins. This is the true body of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, given for you in your sins. Take and eat. This is the true body of your Lord, given for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take and eat. This is the true body of your Lord, given for you on the cross for the forgiveness of all of your sins. This is his blood, shed for the remission of all of your sins. Take and eat. This is the true body of your Lord. This is his blood shed for your sins. And now may this, the true body and blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in the one true and saving faith unto life everlasting. Amen. Depart in God's peace. Amen. Please join now in the Nunc Dimittis. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. For God the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you, that for his sake you have given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. We ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule in our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord be with you. Bless we the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. Please join now in the concluding hymn.
Please be seated. Greetings to you this morning. Good to see you this morning. We do a fellowship after the service here this morning, so please do take an opportunity to enjoy that. Also, this is meeting day, so both the ladies and the guild and the council will meet. We're down to three council members, so all three of you guys, please remember, don't take off. Okay, we do have a meeting. I don't expect it to be a long one, but please do stay for the meeting. I appreciate it. We have Bible class still continuing this week, on Tuesday only this week. No Saturday class this week. Thank you, and good morning.